HarperCollins presents 90 Days, the true story of the hunt for Rajiv Gandhi's assassins. Written by Anirudhya Mitra. Read by Adwait, Karambelkar. A note for listeners before we begin. This audiobook begins with an introduction to its extensive cast of characters, and the transcript is also available in the enhanced PDF that can be downloaded with this title from your audiobook provider. Listeners who are not in need of this introduction can jump straight to the first chapter. Dedicated to my wife, Ruma Mitra, and sons, Arjun and Prithvi Mitra. Pets Bruno, Sasha, Sugar and Vaitu. Prologue by Justice K.T. Thomas J., Supreme Court of India. Rajiv Gandhi, a former Prime Minister of India, was assassinated on 21st May 1991 at a place called Sriperumbudur in Tamil Nadu. The assassin was an adolescent girl named Dhanu, who was made into a human bomb. She got herself exploded at 10:19 p.m. at close proximity with the visiting former Prime Minister. In a trice, the life of Rajiv Gandhi was snuffed out and his body smashed into smithereens. As for the assassin, nothing except a few pieces of charred limbs and her sundered head were found. In the explosion, the lives of 18 others were also extinguished. Investigation pointed to a minutely orchestrated cabal, masterminded by conspirators to extirpate the former Prime Minister from this terrestrial terrain. In the final charge sheet made by the Central Bureau of Investigation, also known as the CBI, all the 26 appellants now before us were arraigned as members of the conspiracy, which targeted, inter alia, Rajiv Gandhi. The special judge who tried the case found all the 26 appellants guilty of various offences charged, the gravamen of them being Section 302, read with Section 120B of the IPC. All of them were hence convicted of those offences and sentenced to death. Preface. Anirudhya Mitra, 11th April, 2022. It's been 30 years that I've been asking myself whether to write a book on the assassination of India's former Prime Minister, Rajiv Gandhi. It is during these 3 decades that friends, seniors, and government officials have asked me why I have never thought of writing a book, even after extensively covering one of the biggest crimes in modern Indian history for the India Today magazine. And when I finally did, the very first question my publisher asked me was why I wrote the book after all these years. The story, Rajiv Assassination, the Inside Story, on the 15th July 1991 issue of the India Today magazine, had got people talking. While the general response was euphoric, a section of the media felt I was sensationalizing it. The truth is, I had suppressed much more information than I could and had revealed. By the time the Central Bureau of Investigation, also known as the CBI, filed the charge sheet, which was 11 months after the assassination, I had a surfeit of concealed facts. The former Prime Minister's assassination was the product of a conspiracy. The plotters and key operators came not just from the Tamil guerrilla separatist organization, LTTE, or The Liberation Tigers of Tamil Eelam, but had links across the globe. And as the probe gained traction, followed by the seizure of incriminating documents and arrests made, Sivarasan emerged as the mastermind of the complex web that eventually took Rajiv Gandhi's life. It became evident that he was regularly in touch with contacts in Singapore, Saudi Arabia, the UAE, Sweden, France, and the UK before and after carrying out the assassination. There have been many theories and conclusions, including the Supreme Court of India's verdict based on the findings of the CBI's Special Investigation Team, or the SIT, upholding the death sentence awarded to the assassins. The number of death sentences awarded to the 23 accused in the Madras TADA, or Terrorist and Disruptive Activities Prevention Act, court, came down to 7 in the Supreme Court. But the fate of the key conspirators, such as Sandan, Murugan, Nalini and gang, remained unaltered. The Jain Inquiry Commission, headed by Justice Milab Chand Jain, set up to look into the, quote, larger conspiracy behind the assassination, was flooded with allegations against the P.V. Narasimha Rao government, slowing down the pace of inquiry and ignoring, hiding and suppressing vital evidence that could have led the investigators to the doorstep of some influential people in Delhi. But what nobody could throw light on was Rao's motive. One of the finest officers in the SIT, Amit Verma, was later inducted into the commission to assist Justice Jain. Incidentally, Verma had huge differences of opinion with his chief, D.R. Karthikeyan, over the possibility of a, quote, foreign hand in the assassination. The commission was looking into one Amos Radia and Georgi Betchar as agents operating for the Israelis in India. And in the days that followed, startling depositions and intelligence intercepts made before the commission indicated that Subramanian Swami may have had prior knowledge of a threat to Rajiv and had communicated the same to the former Prime Minister's party. But no one, whether in his party or the government, had reacted in a timely manner. In fact, Swami had had an argument with the then Research and Analysis Wing, or RAW, chief in a cabinet committee meeting that was held within hours of the killing. Justice Jain devoted separate chapters to 3 key Indian players who were suspected, one way or the other, to have had prior knowledge of the assassination. The evidence looked more circumstantial, though, but a political will to examine them further was shamelessly ignored by New Delhi. In my journalism career spanning over 10 years, there was no place better than India today for investigating the Rajiv Gandhi assassination case. It was my greatest experience, the most rewarding, and yes, the most controversial. While India Today backed me to the hilt, there was no dearth of opposition. After the breaking story of how the conspiracy was hatched, a celebrated journalist from a southern daily accused me of yellow journalism. A fellow crime reporter suggested I was writing fiction. A leading politician from Tamil Nadu labelled me anti-Tamil. And the LTTE Supremo called me an agent of the CBI in his interview to the Western media. A former prime minister called my editor and asked if the story of the dry run conducted in his political rally in Tamil Nadu was true. An official from 10 Janpath asked if I could share my stories with Rajiv's family before they were published. Even the SIT boss called parts of my story figments of my imagination. But he had no explanation to offer when 3 well-known people, who were named in the story, were arrested by the same SIT. The celebrated journalist from the Southern Daily, too, kept quiet, failing to substantiate his charges. Understandably, my editor-in-chief was concerned. He tapped his own sources in the government and was told that every story published by the magazine was factually correct, thus adding to my motivation to keep chasing the bigger story. But then the threats started coming in from other quarters. Suspicious characters would follow my car in Madras, call my hotel room and not speak, or leave a note under my door telling me not to visit Jaffna in Sri Lanka. It's another matter that I was not granted a visa to visit Jaffna, but an incident that soon followed shocked me. The Chief Metropolitan Magistrate, or the CMM, was hearing the application of the police remand of the accused, including key conspirators Nalini, Murugan, Peraribalan and Robert Pius. The investigating officer, or IO, of the case, K. Raghuthaman, was standing between Murugan in handcuffs and me. The CMM had asked something, and Raghuthaman had stepped forward to answer. Murugan turned, gave me a cold stare, and said something in Tamil, a language not unfamiliar to me. But his accent was heavily Sinhalese. I figured he was trying to find out if I was a, quote, reporter. He repeated his query to Raghuthaman, who, of course, didn't pay him any attention. At the end of the hearing, someone stopped me outside the courtroom and conveyed Murugan's message to me. Stay away from maligning freedom fighters. It was a cold-blooded threat, but I was told not to worry as my stories were, quote, getting noticed. Meanwhile, I was getting involved in the investigation deeper and deeper, even as the legend of, quote, One-Eyed Jack, as Sivarasan was sometimes called, grew larger by the day. He managed to stay ahead of the CBI, RAW, the Intelligence Bureau, or the IB, Military Intelligence, or the MI, and state police across the country, in a clear indication that India's biggest manhunt so far was not good enough to catch him. But one thing was clear to the CBI. Sivarasan was holed up somewhere in India. While the agencies left no stone unturned to find him, the mastermind played his own tricks. He handpicked his lookalikes from the cadres of his organization and sent them across the country in disguise, just to keep the security agencies engaged in chasing, quote, him to every corner of the country, and then return disappointed. Unlike the SIT, mine was a one-man army, and I was lucky to have the right contacts in the CBI. The SIT boss Karthikeyan was not too happy with my, quote, over-enthusiastic approach to staying ahead of rival publications, but would rarely refuse to grant me an appointment. However, covering the developments on the trail of the assassin had become equally challenging for me. I didn't know which lead to follow and which to ignore. However, the relentless chase brought hope when the Indian Navy intercepted a coded communication between Madras and Jaffna, indicating that Sivarasan was asking his boss, Pottu Amman, in Jaffna, for a boat. But the breakthrough was short-lived. Sivarasan discovered his communication with Jaffna was being intercepted by the Indian security agencies. As I wrote in one of my stories in the India Today magazine, I quote, instead of seizing transmission, he used the knowledge to run rings around the SIT. On one occasion, the SIT rushed a 60-man force to Pulikat Lake on the Tamil Nadu-Andhra Pradesh border. They combed every inch of the 600 square kilometer lake, only to find they had been handed another red herring. Unquote. The Robert Ludlum-like plot continued to thicken, and the tasks and targets kept multiplying. Raids by the SIT's tracking team kept failing. Fingers were pointed at the SIT and their inability to catch the mastermind, who, showing a clean pair of heels, sneaked out of Tamil Nadu, hiding in an oil tanker, and landed in neighboring Karnataka. Sivarasan had, by then, grown bigger than everyone. I visited the residence of retired Director General, Intelligence of Tamil Nadu Police, Kondath Mohandas. The ace sleuth questioned the, quote, intriguing circumstances in which Sriperumbudur had been added to Rajiv Gandhi's itinerary despite objections from several quarters. He pointed out an earlier report where Yasser Arafat, chairman of the Palestine Liberation Organization, had warned India about a possible threat from the Mossad, Israel's national intelligence agency. Mohandas emphatically claimed that the LTTE was being used as a front by vested interests operating not just from Jaffna. Meanwhile, I could see a clear divide within the SIT. While one section felt the investigation did not need to not look beyond the LTTE, a few others felt overlooking the foreign links of Sivarasan would not only be a disservice to their profession, but also an injustice to Rajiv Gandhi. They dared to do what no other CBI official attempted: bring Rajiv's true assassins to justice. Ridiculed by the press, denounced by their seniors, and harassed by New Delhi, these officers were tormented by those who clung fast to the idea of the LTTE as the only villain in the conspiracy. With their career on the line, at least two officers persisted in the belief that the footprints of the assassins would lead them beyond Jaffna. This, therefore, is the story of the officers who successfully brought the conspirators to trial, but were prevented every step of the way from unearthing the larger conspiracy. This is also the story of the pervasive subterfuge, outright lies and deceptions of the intelligence agencies, the sympathetic stance of some very senior policemen from Tamil Nadu who owed their allegiance to the LTTE, and the mysterious deaths of key witnesses just before their testimonies were due. It was a complex web where not only was the truth forbidden, but also where the necessity to catch the mastermind alive was systematically jeopardized. Over the years, it was my inability to decide what information to keep and what to leave out, if any at all, that stopped me from writing on a subject as sensitive as the assassination of a world leader. When I reconnected with some of the officials who had cracked the case, I realized.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.